As well, who work with us and our initiatives are Tony Tapia, Maria Coronado, Angela Azul, Aurelio Avalos, and Rosario Mendoza. They too are involved with our initiatives and help advance the work of the foundation. Yes. And lastly, I want to thank our advisors from the Rose Community Foundation. Ann Garcia, Interim Chief Executive Officer, CFO, Therese Ellery, Senior Program Officer, Elsa Holguin, Senior Program Officer, and Janet Lopez, Senior Program Officer, for their advising and helping us move forward. So thank you. Today's theme is about Connect, Inspire, Act, mapping our strengths to build community. Build power, community. This morning, we talked a lot about what it meant to build power from a personal level, from a community level, from a political level, through a collective level, through many ways. And we had a historical perspective also, especially through a very interesting labor movement of how Latinos in labor provided labor for this country and how that came about and the power that's built within that. We talked about movement building. We talked about mobilizing. And we've been able to go ahead and bring these concepts together in a shared and a community way to challenge our thinking about how do we collectively really ignite the power within us and then collectively bring it together so that we can make great change in our communities. And so today and this afternoon, we'll still have a great presenter who will talk about that. But before we go there, I'd like to go ahead and introduce to you good friend of mine, Roberta Robinet, who is the president of Colorado AT&T, our Gold Luncheon sponsor. I met Roberta about 3 years ago. She came to our event. We started talking about getting to know each other. She's from Pueblo, native, and how not just her commitment, but the commitment of AT&T to making sure that there's leadership in every corner of our state. And so, you know, when you meet someone and you connect and you like feel like you've known them for years, that was kind of like my relationship with Roberta. we met and we're like, my God, it feels like we've known each other for such a long time. And I think that because our values connected. You know, they were aligned. The way she thinks, the way she offers herself to community, the way she helps to build community was something that we were able to go ahead and really connect. And since then, AT&T has supported our event every year. Even further than that, well, let's get... Even further than that, last year she said to us, how else can I help you guys? I mean, it's rare when someone comes and says to you, how else can we help you all? And for those of you who were here last year, we launched our Latinas Lead initiative, and Roberta and her team said, how can we support this new initiative? And earlier this year, we held our first Latina Power Summit, where it was sold out with over 125 women, and AT&T was our premier sponsor and said, go get it done, Carlos. So with that said, I'd like to go ahead and introduce to you Roberta Robinette, my friend and president of Colorado AT&T.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And Carlos, thank you for your friendship, your partnership. I truly adore everything that you do. And Carlos is right. When he and I first met and we started talking, it truly was a connection. And that's because, again, I'd like to think it's because of my Pueblo roots, and which I'm sure all of you know very well is a very strong Latino community. And so when I moved to Denver and I had the opportunity to come and work for AT&T, and again, woo, I love the fact that they are so helpful in helping me find community programs that really, it's more than just putting our name onto something. It's something where we really want to be active and have our employees engage. And so I also want to recognize some of our employees that are here today, because AT&T has an employee resource group, HACEMOS, which has a very active employee resource group. I'm proud that they're here today and participating in our events, but they do a lot throughout the community throughout the year as well, and so I want to make sure that we recognize them and all the good work that they do. I get to come and speak to all of these groups, but it truly is our employees that are the boots on the ground and working with all of you to make sure that we have that community engagement. And so I just want to thank them. I want to thank all of you for the opportunities that you've provided for AT&T to really connect with the community. So thank all of you. I also want to thank all of you for your participation and really engaging with our youth and with our communities, because as Carlos said, it is so important for everybody to be engaged. You know, I do a lot of community engagement. I also work a lot with our government affairs programs. I work at the federal, state, and local level, and I can't stress enough how important it is that everybody hears from you, because I see it. When I'm working with them, they want to hear from their communities what's going on, what's important to them. And so for you guys to get out there and not only make your voices heard, but to encourage our youth to engage as well, because we sometimes lose that. And I know with everything going on today, it's hard for folks to think that their voices are being heard. But I want to tell you today, they are. So keep up the good work, keep up the fight, and let our youth know that their voices are heard and that they are important. I love our partnership with the Latino Community Foundation. Every time I sit down with Carlos, he's always got so much energy, and it just translates to what I want to do with him. And that's why I come to Carlos and say, what more can we do? How can I help? It's because of his energy, his staff's energy. And so thank you for letting us be a part of this. I'm so excited about, again, being a sponsor of today's luncheon. I'm excited to hear what our speakers in the afternoon have to say, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Roberta. Since 2007, we have come a long way. And we've come a long way with the support of the Rose Community Foundation. Since the beginning, they've been committed to seeing the Latino Community Foundation of Colorado flourish in many ways. I've been a part of the Latino Community Foundation as a staff and then previously as a board member. for about 6-7 years. And the foundation, Rose Community Foundation, has really been there side by side through ups and downs to making sure that we're able to go ahead and advance our mission. With that said, I'd like to go ahead and introduce Ann Garcia, the Interim Chief Executive Officer and Chief Financial Officer of the Rose Community Foundation, to also welcome you and say a few words. Ann?
Good afternoon, and thank you all for being here today. Again, great energy in this room. There always is at this event. I think we all come away with tons of ideas and ways that we're going to, you know, take what we learn here and actually deliver in the community. So it's great to see you all here today. You know, Carlos just mentioned Rose Community Foundation and the Latino Community Foundation, and I just want to make sure kind of you know what that connection is. I think it's confusing sometimes to people. The Rose Community Foundation has spent more than 2 decades working in the community, building relationships, working with donors, and actually doing very strategic grant making in the community in 5 areas that we focus on that we believe make for a healthy community. So aging, child and family development, education, health, and Jewish love. And we really try to tackle some of the most enduring problems in these areas. And believe me, there's a lot of enduring problems that we're taking care of. But as a community foundation deeply connected to the communities that we serve, we also realize that sometimes being a leader in this community means that we have to really address emerging issues. And one of those emerging issues arose in 2007 when we were looking around the community and not really seeing sort of the leadership and the energy around the Latino community that we felt should be there. And so Rose Community Foundation, together with our partners, so the J. and Rose Phillips Family Foundation and the Western Union Foundation, launched the Latino Community Foundation, and that was, my goodness, 10 years ago, right? And really, they've become a resource to the community and a catalyst for change, and you're going to hear more about that a little later in the program. But over the past 10 years, yes, I mean, we've officed with the Latino Community Foundation. We've watched them grow and become really a powerful force in our community. And we've supported that effort with over $1.9 million in operating support programs, support and grant making. And we believe in this effort and all the great work Carlos and his staff and all of you have done. We are very proud to see how they have grown, and particularly in today's world, we're so grateful to have a partner like the Latino Community Foundation, as we are investing in work to support immigrants and refugees to ensure that Denver is a safe and welcoming place for this important part of our community. So we're really grateful for your perspective and all the support that we receive from the Latino Community Foundation as well. So let me turn it back to Carlos, and he's got much more to share with you. But again, I'm so grateful to be here with you today. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Ann. Like I said, you know, for the past 10 years, we've invested about $5.3 million. We've partnered up with about a little over 100 organizations throughout the state of Colorado. Nothing is more gratifying than to know that the investments that we are able to go ahead and collect from our community and then reinvest those back out into our community again in a way that builds community and allows people to thrive and help to transform lives is incredible. You know, there's probably about 6 Latino foundations in the country. And there's some other like Hispanic funds that operate at the foundations, but there's very few of us. And I always say we are so lucky here in Colorado to have a foundation. Not because of the work, you know, or because I'm there, or because we have a great board, we have a leadership, whatever. Because it allows us to harness the talent in our community and help activate it and provide the resources so that they know how best to go ahead and people in their own community, in their neighborhoods, in their backyards. And I think that's really a privilege to be able to have that. On Thursday, I leave to San Antonio to help Latino Community Foundation there really get back up and going. They've been kind of like going, and it's like they said to me the other day, how have you done it? What did you do? And I basically say, we have a community. We reach out to the community, we engage them, we involve them, and in turn, they're the ones who empower us to do the work that we do. So, thank you. So to bring our work a little bit more to life of what we do, those of you who attended our 10th anniversary celebration last month got to see it, but we're gonna show you a quick video about the work of the Latino Community Foundation.
The Latino Community Foundation of Colorado invests in shaping a better narrative for Latinos, tackling critical issues in the community, and cultivating the philanthropic power of Latinos. A decade ago, 14 visionary families came together with several foundations to form Colorado's first Latino Foundation. Today, the Latino Community Foundation has invested over $5.3 million in Latino communities across Colorado. This initiative of the Rose Community Foundation has helped establish the groundwork for building strong Latino-led organizations and cultivating emerging leaders. With the Latino Community Foundation, we're givers and investors of social change in our communities. Along with our partners, the Latino Community Foundation is investing in the success of Colorado's Latino students through the HIP to College program. As high as 70% of graduating Latino high school seniors who intend to pursue higher education abandon this goal before the fall, a phenomenon called summer melt. HIP to College provides resources to help these students stay on track. Daniela is a graduate of York International School in Thurgood and a freshman at the University of Colorado Denver studying mathematics. She's the first person in her family to attend college.
I love math because it's something that I always understood. There's one answer, but there's many different ways to get to that answer. What I really like to do most of the time is just philanthropy, so helping in whatever I can with my teachers or parents or youth roots. I just like doing it. It makes me feel like my day is completed. Being the oldest, you just have to always make sure to be a role model for your siblings. My parents have always told me, get an education, get an education. It's important. You want to be able to follow your dreams. It's really crazy for my family. Since I am the first one, they don't really know what to do. I also have people like Ms. Bailey who help me out on this GT.
Daniela's HIP to College counselor, Ms. GT, has helped her to navigate the complexities of beginning college, from applications and scholarships to registering and selecting a major.
She's always been supportive. So if I'm like, Ms. GT, I'm stuck here, she's like, okay, well, we're gonna get you through it. And then seeing, hey, I got these scholarships now, I got accepted. And then once I'm here, it's like, oh my God, I'm going to college. I've been so excited. And the fact that for the first year I have that financial weight off my shoulders, it's just so much relief and excitement and a little bit of nervousness. My dream job would just be something that just makes my love for mathematics and philanthropy together. So I could be helping people and yet still be able to like mix math into it. I'd be doing what I love to do for the rest of my life. And I feel like that would just make every single day amazing.
Four community organizations have developed transition programs that each year assist 1,000 Latino high school seniors' successful transition to higher education. Latino Age Wave Colorado is a foundation initiative that seeks to improve the lives of Latino seniors and their caregiving families so they might thrive in community. By building relationships with local Latino residents, we can identify and address their needs and serve as an intermediary between residents and service providers, so their voices are heard. Señora Cipriana Trejo immigrated to the United States from from Mexico in 1962 to work and have a better life. Prior to joining the H-Wave group, the señora was isolated with no family or relatives. Now, she has a new lease on life.
Antes me sentía muy sola. No salía de mi apartamento, estaba nomás ahí metida. Antes no oía yo música porque me daba más tristeza.
Señora Cipriani was first connected with H-Wave through a monthly lotería game hosted by the Conectoras, a group of community leaders serving Latino older adults in the Montpelo area.
Ahora soy muy contenta. Tengo muchas amigas también. Y me siento en familia. Ya no me siento triste. Nos platicamos mucho, nos cantamos, jugamos la lotería, comemos, nos reímos. Para mí es alegría que no tenía por más de 30 años. Me ha crecido la familia de un momento a otro. No tenía yo a nadie, ahora ya tengo mucha familia. Toda la diferencia del mundo. Ahora ya no me deprimo, ya mejor oigo música, veo televisión, las dos cosas al mismo tiempo. My family and this problem. Now my family is big.
Colorado's Latino population is growing. Latino H-Wave and other foundation programs are strengthening our communities as we grow. The Latino Community Foundation is committed to creating thriving communities rooted in opportunity. In the next decade, we will harness our collective power to address complex issues. We will grow our impact and support leaders that transform our communities. And we will cultivate a new generation of Latino philanthropists.
Two of our initiatives that we have. We also have two other ones, one on immigration, and another one as well as Latinas Lead. We also give grants to organizations as well to help develop their capacity. This year we're breaking a big mark where we're looking to probably have invested $1 million back into the community this year through our initiatives and through grants out to the community. So, and currently, we have two grant opportunities open right now, one through our Young Latino Philanthropists, which are small mini grants. So if there's things you want to go ahead and spark or inspire in your community, please apply for those. And we also have some other grants, folks working with immigrants. So the two of those proposals are out on our website. You can get more information. And the best thing about that, one thing that we really believe in investing is that we don't make things complicated for people. So it's a simple one-page application that to fill out to be reviewed for that. So also, at your table, there's envelopes. I'm not gonna have a big hard ask or anything like that, but if you so feel moved, your heart feels that there's a connection to the work that we do, I invite you to give, because again, we're supported through the generosity of our community, of our corporate sponsors, and foundations that support our work that we do. So you're welcome to go ahead and fill that out. It's no pressure. You can drop it off at the registration desk. There is a box there. Now I'm going to invite Anne to come back to the stage with me to go ahead and do an introduction of our Soul Awards.
To make sure I got that last bite of chicken done before he stopped. So this is really exciting. So in 2014, the Latino Community Foundation of Colorado inaugurated the Soul of Leadership Award, and it pays homage to a Latina leader or organization that has demonstrated the following: courageous leadership, that they embody high standards of integrity, is deeply committed to the advancement of Latinos. Now, when you think about those, and I didn't go on about them, but the people that we are going to present this award to this year really embody those qualities. And I'm very excited that today we're going to present the 2017 Soul Award to Rosemary Rodriguez and her her son, Trini Rodriguez.
Thank you. Before they come up, I just want to just share a little bit about them. But I want to share a personal story about Rosemary. And she kind of like knows the story a little bit. About 35 years ago, when I was in college, I decided that right after college, I would open my own business. And in doing so, I went to this one event about, I think it was the Latino Business Association that had sponsored it there in Los Angeles. I'm from Los Angeles. So I went to the event, and when I went there, I met this woman by the name of Edie Lopez. And we really connected, and I told her what I wanted to do after college. And she said, well, I will help you write a business plan. I said, great, wonderful. So I visited her, and we became really good friends. And she actually was living in Colorado before she moved to California. And so she would tell me about these stories about her and two good friends of hers, which would always be doing crazy stuff, and they had young children, and just how they really built family. And because she didn't really know anybody, that we became really close, and she would share these stories about these two friends of hers. Fast forward, I moved here 10 years ago, and I still connect with Edie. And I was telling her shortly after I moved here that, you know, I had moved here and so forth, and she said to me, by the way, do you happen to know a woman by the name of Rosemary Rodriguez? I said, actually, I do. She goes, that's one of the girls I kept on telling you about that I was growing up and just doing all these wonderful things. So it's a small world. You just never know when things come together. So to me, it's really special to be able to go ahead and kind of like present this award to Rosemary, who I indirectly knew about 35 years ago and who I've really gotten close to get to know her in the past 10 years. Rosemary is currently the director of Together We Vote, a civic engagement project promoting census participation and nonpartisan redistricting involvement in hard-to-reach communities. She's formerly the state director for Senator Michael Bennett of the Bennett of Colorado. She served as commissioner for the U.S. Election Assistance Commission, chairing the commission in 2008. Prior to that, she served on the Denver City Council for 3.5 years and was council president from 2005 to 2006. In 2015, she was elected to the Denver Public School Board of Education, representing Southwest Denver. She served on a 15-member panel assembled by the Denver Mayor John Hickenlooper in investigating faults with the Denver Election Commission and spearheaded election reform changes to the city charter, which Denver voters approved. In 2006, she was nominated to the Election Assistance Commission by President George Bush and confirmed by the Senate. She is a Colorado native, attended Metropolitan State College, where she studied political science. She has received numerous awards for service to her community and spends much of her free time organizing the Cafecito, a place where Latina professionals gather for friendship, encouragement, and mutual support. Her son, Trinidad Rodriguez, or Trini, is a senior vice president, managing director, public finance at D.A. Davidson & Company, and has been a public finance investment banker since 1999. In that time, he has structured and underwritten tax-exempt and taxable bonds to finance public and nonprofit issues, capitals, and investment projects. He has financed over $800 million in tax-exempt bonds for independent schools, higher education, nonprofit institutions, and has also served as a policy advisor in the Colorado Governor's Office. His community involvement spans many organizations in Colorado. He currently serves as a trustee and is a member of the Education Committee at Rose Community Foundation, serves as chairman of the Downtown Denver Partnerships Denver Civic Ventures Board, is on the boards of the Colorado Fiscal Institute and the Winter Park Recreation Association, and has served on the boards of Urban Peak and the New American School. He is also past chair and current member of the Denver Housing Board of Commissioners. He holds a BA from Economics from the University of Massachusetts at Amherst, lives here in Denver with his wife, Sarah, and has a daughter, Catalina. Please join me in honoring Rosemary Rodriguez and Trini Rodriguez as our 2017 Soul Award recipients.
Tremendous honor by an amazing organization. I feel incredibly lucky to be honored in this way alongside my mom, who has served as the primary model for what it means to be a citizen, member of the community, and you know, to see her recognized in this way and to share that, you know, recognition is an amazing, amazing honor. I was told we were at about 5 minutes up here, so I prepared a little bit more than my mom to say, which is a really not the right way this should be happening. She should be speaking for an hour, given her wisdom. But I do want to take this moment to thank, you know, my family, my amazing mom, my wife who's here, for their tremendous support and guidance, and my colleagues who at DA Davidson, who are incredibly supportive and without whose encouragement and most importantly, patience, I wouldn't have nearly the time or opportunity to spend as much time as I do in the community. And so if you see one of my business partners from DA Davidson, Eric Duran or Brandon DeBenedet out on the street or at an event, Please express the appreciation to them as well. Latino Community Foundation and Rose. Latino Community Foundation and Carlos and the team have brought such an amazing and important voice to the broader Rose community and organization by, particularly in these times, these very trying times since November, to lend, you know, the insight about what it means to be inclusive and protect people who are vulnerable. Rose has, it's probably no secret, set aside some money right in response to the November elections to really make a targeted effort at mitigating the immediate and most challenging impacts of the November election and the rhetoric that surrounded it. And I applaud and the team at Rose, many of whom were mentioned, my fellow board members at Rose, but also Carlos, his unique sort of strength in helping guide us through that conversation. I'll just say one thing, maybe in honor of my mom, about myself and my story. I'm an investment banker. I've been for about 20 years, as you heard a little bit, and I consider my success in large part thanks to Rosemary and the investment she made in me as a single mom here in Denver. times were not always easy, but she made it seem very easy. So thanks, Mom, for all that. in my work as an investment banker, I focus on financing infrastructure, which is, you know, the built environment of our public agencies that really is the foundation and the key element that allows society to function. This creates, you know, infrastructure, as kind of boring and humdrum as it is, creates amazing opportunity for communities to realize their vision, whether they're libraries or school buildings, walking paths, or hospitals. These are sort of the lifeblood of forming a vibrant community where everyone has a chance to succeed. And in my work, I focus on making that financing for the infrastructure as efficient as I possibly can, really to provide, make sure there's as much money for the software of our society, which are the programs that are operated by our cities and counties, state and local governments, education institutions. And because that, you know, we really, not to diminish the importance of infrastructure, you know, those soft investments, software type, programmatic type investments are really what, you know, is truly exciting. And the reason they're so exciting in my view is that what better thing in our world do we have to invest in than our neighbors and the people of this great country. So that is, in many ways, you know, the vital investment. And that has, you know, certainly been the guiding light, you know, for my career. But in honor of LCFC, I just want to make a quick comment about philanthropy and, you know, identify a problem that's, I think, pervasive and the key role that philanthropy and all of you have in addressing this critical problem. There's a war on more public investment taking place. And it has some clear beneficiaries. They're the people who want to pay less in taxes. And the role that philanthropy plays, I believe, as I'm learning more from my colleagues at Rose and bearing witness to the true power of philanthropy, is, you know, the traditional model, which is philanthropy is the seed capital for good ideas that become good programs and you know, are risky to invest in, that, you know, public agencies can't, you know, yet justify, you know, the investment in a given program. And that is a truly powerful role that philanthropy plays. But there's another one that I think, and that's, you know, not enough, and it's hard to say not enough to people who give so much, but it's not about necessarily giving more, but maybe also giving a little bit in a different way. you know, this loud push against more public investment, you know, we've seen it in the federal budget that was adopted a couple weeks ago, and we see it closer to home in the form of the Taxpayers' Bill of Rights, or TABOR, which I take as a personal responsibility to work to restructure TABOR and unshackle the ability of state and local governments to make these critical investments. But I think real quick, when we examine how this war on public investment takes place, it's comprised of a few key ingredients. One is dehumanization of our neighbors. To say that person isn't worth making an investment in. And it's truly sad that we have to remind ourselves that this is a you know, we have to prove the case, but it's true. Or the other common statement is wasting government, is the other, you know, big criticism of why we shouldn't give government more money, because there's too much waste as it is. And then the third one is, well, there's not enough money, and we have to, you know, we have to choose priorities. And that's a, you know, pretty reasonable statement. We all budget our own households, you know, we have to make hard choices. But it's not a reason not to make more investment on its own. It just, absolutely isn't, especially when you look at the share of GDP that, you know, these public programs represent today versus 10 or 20 years ago. So what is the power that philanthropy has given those few problems that, you know, I focus on? Number one is to tell the stories. And, you know, that came up in the little bit of the presentation I heard a moment ago, but telling the stories of those who need this investment and those who are helped and how they're helped, and tell it in a way that's broadly accessible, because the greatest power that, you know, everyone in this room has the ability to tap into is the powerful force of 50% plus one person voting for more investment. So I'd ask you to think of sort of these stories and making them broadly accessible, because you can buy elections, it's possible, but you know, 50% plus one can form, you know, the outcome and drive the outcome of an election for more of this investment. So, you know, a good friend of mine on the Rose Community Foundation Education Committee, Cody Belsley, said in the, you know, I think we had our first meeting after the November elections, presidential election, and she said, you know, now is an opportunity for all of us of, quote, like mind, to stop worrying about the how we, you know, improve whatever it is, education, healthcare, but that we all focus on, we have to improve these, because now there is a case, again, that has to be made, that we have to do this work, and it's not the how that's as important. We will lose the battle if we're constantly debating over how, and turn back our attention to the why we must do this. So with that, again, I thank you of LCFC and look forward to hearing your stories to make this powerful change.
Hello. Hello. There's no coffee, I know, on the table, but there's tea, there's water. So, hi everyone. My name is Luis Colon. I'm on the board of the Latino Community Foundation of Colorado. I have been on the board since its founding in 2007, and I'm going to tell you a little story about that, because the situation today is eerily similar to what it was back in 2006, 2007, when we were talking about, you know, sort of seeding the foundation with some resources to make its work happen. So you may remember back in 2006, for those of you who were in Colorado already, the legislature passed what at the time were the most stringent anti-immigrant laws in the nation. And the rhetoric around the state regarding the Latino community was very difficult to hear. It was very negative. It was very, just like it is today in many places around the nation. Right. So Ron Montoya approached my wife Toti and I and said, hey, you know, in his very democratic manner, he says, what do you think of the state of the state? And I replied in a less than democratic manner. My deep disappointment in what was going on, and he said, okay, well, come to my house, and he gave us a date, and so my wife and I go to his house, and it was a gathering of the 14 families that Anne alluded to before, where we talked about What can we do to change that rhetoric around our community? How can we showcase what our community is truly all about family values, about education, about caring for each other, about community, and so on? And that was, I think, late 2006. So in 2007, with the assistance and partnership of the Rose Community Foundation, the Latino Community Foundation was born. So it's been 10 years. You've seen over there in those posters sort of the achievements, and those of you who were able to come to our 10th anniversary event have heard a lot. So I'm not going to go into a lot of detail other than, just 10 years ago, the rhetoric was very similar as it is today, and we are going to stand and make sure that everybody here in the state and elsewhere hears what all the great things our community is able to do and does on a daily basis. So with that, before I introduce our main speaker, I want to thank Carlos, because his leadership of the organization has been amazing. And I'm going to tell you a little bit of Ruben, but I'm going to be very fast because I know you want to hear him and not me. We all know he's a syndicated columnist. How many of you have actually read his columns? Quite a bit. So I'll tell you, I'm not going to go through his typical background, but I'll tell you that those of you who haven't read it, I'll give you a taste. And back earlier this month, you wrote a column that addressed the controversy around the National Football League's issues with the anthem, right? But he, in his unique style and humor, wrote about it, addressed it, and then transitioned into, this is what I'm telling my kids, and he has three kids, all under the age of 12. This is what I'm telling my kids about this and what we can learn about this situation. He told them, don't be a victim, because you will face injustice, and you realize at that point that life is not fair, so don't act like a victim, because it weakens you and empowers the others. Overcoming adversity builds character. He also said, you don't have to go through life accommodating other people, but you don't have to go around antagonizing them either, just simply because I don't agree with you. And then the third point is, and this is a really key one, some people will have negative expectations of you. But you don't have to fulfill them. People have a right to be idiots, and some choose to exercise it. So just don't make them right. So that's, in short, a little taste of what Ruben is all about. We just met today, but I feel like I've known you for a very long time, and it's a pleasure to welcome you here. And without further ado, come on up.
I got nervous when we started pulling out a column. I thought, oh no, what have I said now? What did I write now? Thank you so much for welcoming me back to Denver. I didn't even let a minor knee injury get in the way of bringing me here, because I'm getting older. That's the main reason. I've been coming to Denver now. The Denver Post has been writing my column for 16 or 17 years. It was one of my initial clients. I had 25 clients when I launched a long time ago, when there were about 10 Latino syndicated columnists in the country. Now there are 5. So we're not going forward, folks, at least in that space. But it was one of my first clients, and I've come back to Denver so many times. My wife and I love coming here. We love coming to Colorado, all different parts of it, and I've spoken in different places. My column runs in Pueblo and Colorado Springs and in Denver, and then probably a couple of others I can't remember at the moment. But I'm going to talk for about 15 minutes or so. And let's see if I can pull this off. The trick is not speaking long. The trick is speaking short. So we're going to speak for about 15 minutes, and then we're going to take my favorite part, which is your questions, if we have time for questions. I hope we do. First, I want to thank Carlos Martinez, who I had a chance to spend some time with last night. People have talked about his energy and his ideas. I think also one of the things I picked up on him right away, he has a sense of independence. He's not locked in a box. A lot of our Latino leaders, local level, state level, federal level, whatever, are stuck in a box. They think now exactly the way they thought 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 50 years ago. And he's not like that. He's committed to doing the work where it matters at the grassroots level, but he is a pragmatist who will not keep doing things that don't work. So in that regard, I think he's a really good investment, because it's not simply checking the box, you know, I have this foundation. It's a, he's constantly pushing it, constantly seeing what can be done. We had that conversation in the brief time that we met. I also want to thank the Rose Community Foundation, which started 20 years ago with an important mission, and has since adopted the Latino Community Foundation and incorporated the two, and you really see the messages and the missions are very similar. There's great overlap. I'll tell you in a bit about, at the end, about one of the career highlights for me, and that was a trip to Israel I took with a group of journalists about 5 years ago. And the fact that when you end up in an audience with the Prime Minister of Israel and he wants to talk to you about the Latino community in the United States, and you're sitting there with a journalist and you want to talk to him about Iran and nuclear weapons and all sorts of things, but he is intensely curious about what he hears about the Latino community in the United States, it really does send a message that, you know, we may not always appreciate it, but it is appreciated around the world, that this is a very important subsection, these 54 million Latinos in the country, which they say we help elect presidents. I'm not always sure of that, but at least that's what it says in the brochure. We also have $1.7 trillion in buying power. We're represented in every state. We'll soon be 25% of the entire population. So we're an important population for sure. I want to tell you 6 things about me to just kick things off, and then I'll get to the bulk of the remarks here. And this timer will go off when I'm done. So 6 things about me. First of all, 3 of my 4 grandparents were born in the United States. My Mexican grandfather, came from Mexico, from Chihuahua. He came during the Mexican Revolution. He did not come legally or illegally, because you couldn't come either way until 1924. So the big misnomer is that 600,000 people they emptied out of Mexico during the Mexican Revolution. They all came legally, because you couldn't come illegally until after the revolution was over. So no gold star for grandpa. I was raised in the mainstream, speaking English, in a rural area in California's San Joaquin Valley, which some of you may know is sort of home to the United Farm Workers Union and other things in the Central Valley. I'm a country mouse. I grew up around the country in rural areas. It approaches the way I see the immigration issue, the water issue, the gun issue, so many other issues. When I was 18, I ran away from home. I ran away to Harvard because I had to get out of my small town of 10,000 people. But almost immediately, I had the inclination to run back. So I did something very unusual. I took a year off from school, and instead of going to Europe like a lot of my colleagues did, I went back and I enrolled at Fresno State, my home town campus college, Fresno State University in Central California. And I took Chicano Studies courses, only Chicano Studies courses. I took 4 in the spring and 4 in the fall, and I learned all about those things and learned all the history that I wasn't picking up at Harvard. Then I went back to Harvard and graduated, so I thought I had kind of the best of both worlds. I had gone to Harvard to become a lawyer, but I became a writer instead. And eventually that morphed after 2,000 columns and a book at 25. I have a healthy self-image, so I wrote my memoir at 25. and I became a commentator, and I do radio and television, hosting shows and speaking, and I became just much more inclined to think of myself as a communicator on various mediums. So if I can reach you through a column, great. If I can reach you through an appearance on Fox News, great. If I can reach you by hosting a radio show in downtown Denver, great. Whatever it takes to get my message across. Also, I've been called a liberal and a conservative, a Republican and a Democrat. You know, from reading my columns, I'm not big on labels because I think, you know, we're all just human beings, and I come from a very complicated community. I think I grew up around Latino conservatives, people who are very conservative. They're called comadres. Comadres, tías, grandmothers. I was not raised by liberals. I didn't know to become a liberal until I went to college. I was raised by conservatives. They were conservative in every way, shape, and form of that word. Some of it because of Catholicism, some of them because of their rules on discipline. You know, I have survived a chancla in my time. gets into a different story. I also want to tell you 6 things that Latinos are good at and 6 things that we are not good at. One is we are good at assimilating. We are completely integrated. There's a group of conservative Republicans out there who think we don't want to assimilate. or integrate, and they're idiots, they have it completely backward. We are so firmly integrated that we all wish we spoke Spanish better. We speak English, we converse in English. If we were any more assimilated and integrated, we'd be vanilla. So we do that well. We do family well. We do that especially well. We have dinner with our parents and grandparents. We bring grandma and grandpa to the house. We have always shown a reluctance to put grandmother and grandfather in nursing homes. We move them in. So we do family well. Oh, and by the way, Trini, you're a good son. I'm gonna tell you that right now. You're a good son. You can ask any politician in America, I do not hand out praise willy-nilly, okay? I'm not easily impressed, but I always tell people you're a good mom, a good dad, or a good son, or a good daughter. Because as you become, you know, try to be a good son, and try to be a good dad, this is not easy. None of it's easy. And you really deserve credit for making those remarks as you did. We're also really good at humility. I've said oftentimes that if they had a humility Olympics, Latinos and especially Mexicans would show up and win all the medals. We also are phenomenally good at work. We have a stigma attached to that one member of the family who will not work. It's unheard of. It's unheard of. You want to shame your family? I don't want to work anymore. Mira, okay, you don't want to work anymore. Yeah. You may have trouble walking, but stuff is good. You're not even working. There is that stigma attached. It's a non-starter in our community that we don't work. So we want to work. So likewise, when people in the immigration debate say that somehow we're coming here to soak up welfare, right, and not work, and then they turn around and argue that we are in fact working and taking their jobs unfairly, and they've got it all confused, we can't do both those things. And also, we're really good at community support. I was so blessed, I grew up in a town of 10,000 people with both sets of grandparents on one street, aunts and uncles everywhere, and I could spend a month there with a dollar in my pocket because every time you went to a tia's house, there was food on the table. And we are really good at that. We are really good at taking care of each other, okay? And when somebody passes away, you know the routine. Somebody passes away, your favorite Theo passed away, they bring food to the house. We sit there and reminisce, right? That's what we're good at. Here's six things we're not good at. We are not good at ignoring the negative naysayers. We care a lot about what people think. We care a lot about what our neighbors and relatives think. The shame of my family, obviously, when they said, Ruben doesn't want to become a lawyer, he's going to become a writer. If you want to know more about that, there's a book called Chicken Soup for the Writer's Soul. I have an essay in there that talks about that transition. But in any case, we're not good at ignoring the naysayers. I live by a different motto. The First Lady, former First Lady of Argentina, Evita Perón, you know, her mantra was, it doesn't matter what the morons say. So remember that. Sometimes the morons are your primos and cousins in the family. Sometimes they're politicians in Washington or whatever, but it doesn't matter what the morons say. We're not good at supporting each other. As was brought up today in the panel, we are not famous for supporting each other. Envidia is a real thing. We are not famous for pulling each other up and supporting one another. We're also not good at accepting different points of view. We stink at critical thinking. We think there's only one view in our Latino community on immigration, on bilingual education, on tax reform, on education reform, on you name it. When in reality, because we're part of the community and the family, we know that's not true. We know that you can't get two Latinos together to agree on anything. I learned this on my trip to Israel. One of their favorite sayings is, two Jews, three opinions. Yeah, we can relate to that. We can relate to that. So we do have this incredible disagreement in the Latino community over various issues, but we gloss over that because we will find out the person who's the dissenter and then beat them into submission. We will call them names. We'll say, you're a conservative, you're a Republican, you're a blah, 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 or you're a whatever on this side. And so we don't do that well. Never have. Never have done that well. We also don't make sense of the past, present, and future. When I saw the presentation this morning, I studied American history. I love hearing about Jorge Gonzalez, the Raza Unida Party, the UFW, Race Tejerina, the whole thing. I took a year off from Harvard to go to Fresno so I could learn those things, right? So I get it. But you can't live there. You can't live there, okay? It's good to know our history, but not to get mired in and stuck in it. And we have trouble reconciling our history with our present, with our future. We oftentimes get stuck in one of them. We can't get out. So we're not good at that. We're also not good at introspection. I find this interesting. Since I wrote my memoir at 25, everybody's got a story to tell, right? We all think we've lived this interesting story. Talk to your Theo, your Thea, your mom, dad. Everybody wants you to write their memoir for them. Fine. So we're good at that. I would argue that we are good at introspection in the micro, looking at ourselves. We are not good at introspection in the macro. we do not think hard about what it takes to tell our story, to get power, to create power, to not be stepped on, to not be treated like a piñata in our American political system, so that politicians beat up on us to please white people who then vote for them and put them in office. The ultimate insult. Both parties do it. Anybody who thinks the Democrats don't do this, they're dreaming. We're being forced two different narratives, forced to digest two narratives. One is that Donald Trump was elected because of four critical Rust Belt states, which is true. It was even more so than Colorado. The Rust Belt states really mattered: Ohio, Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. Four Rust Belt states. In those four Rust Belt states, it was Democrats who voted for Donald Trump. So we are told that racists elected Donald Trump. Okay. I also have a whole bunch of Democrats here who elected Donald Trump. Now let's overlap that. Is it possible that some of those Democrats in the Rust Belt states are also racist against Latinos? Or does the fact that they're Democrats make them immune to that charge? Answer first. Okay, the first answer. People who are afraid of us, people who misunderstand us, people who think that we have come here to take and not to give, people who refuse to acknowledge our productivity, our benefit to this country, the fact that we're patriots, we don't need lectures. We don't need lectures from anybody on that score. We gave it the office, okay? We gave it the office. You grew up in the same household as I did. You saw the picture on the mantle of your Theo who died at Iwo Jima. You saw the Congressional Medal of Honor, the Bronze Star, the Navy Cross, okay? When it comes to patriotism and serving in the military, we do not screw around. We don't wait to be called, we sign up and we go, right? So it is particularly insulting and galling to be accused somehow of not loving our country. Right? We get that. So we need to figure out how we can be introspective. What are we doing wrong in the macro as to why we continue to be mistreated this way by both political parties? And we need to think about that more often. Also, and lastly, as Luis pointed out in the column I wrote, we need to stop being the victim. We need to get off that. We need to stop playing the victim, being the victim, asking for help. It empowers the people who are victimizing us. This is not to say we are not being victimized. I'm not there. I'm not gonna whitewash all that. I'm not gonna tell you some fairy tale story. You know, I didn't just come in here from the Republican National Convention. But I want you not to live there. I want you not to get mired in that. You can think of yourself as being victimized, but don't think of yourself as a victim. Because the whole theme for this conference is about power. It's about having power, right? And it's about how you empower the community. Well, I would say this, it's like that thing that we get on an airplane, they say put the mask on first before you put it on your child. The only way you're gonna empower the community is to first empower yourself. The only way you're gonna save the community is to save yourself. You save yourself first. We have been confused, I think. We go to college and almost initially at orientation, they tell us you've gotta serve your community. You know, you're a college freshman. You don't quite yet know which way's up or what you wanna do or where you wanna go, but you're told you gotta serve the community. If you haven't served the community, then you're a sellout. Now, you gotta empower yourself first, okay? We lack economic power as Latinos. You're trying to talk about that. We lack economic power. We lack power in the media. We don't tell our own stories. I just told you about the lack of syndicated columnists in the country. In media and in storytelling, these incredibly important in Hollywood, people who shape our narratives, they don't look like us. They don't look like us. So we have a lot of work to do and to continue to do, and I think we have to start thinking less about everybody and more about ourselves in that regard. This regard, this does not mean that you're gonna be selfish. It means that you're gonna save your community by saving yourself. And if you multiply that out by a million, by 10 million, it's a paradigm change. It's a paradigm change. So you need to be able to approach it that way. Lastly, let me leave you with this. I think we're okay so far. The theme that we laid out beforehand when we were talking to Carlos about this was know your world, know yourself, and know your path. That's how I think you get to power. That's how I think you tell your own story. So you know your world. That means pick up a newspaper, a website, a computer, a tablet, or whatever. But you are not allowed to be disconnected. You have to tell me right now what's going on in North Korea, the standoff. What's going on in yesterday's developments in the Russia story? What's going on with the Trump dossier? What do we know about the Democrats and Hillary Clinton? What do we know about immigration and why Democrats are really terrible on immigration? We talked before about the Sensenbrenner bill. The 2006 marches. I remember that. I argued with Sensenbrenner directly at an editorial board meeting in San Diego. He did not like me. And it's easy to sort of think Republicans are the problem. But I remember a different version of this. You can Google it if you like. Rahm Emanuel, who's now the mayor of Chicago, was then a member of Congress. He went out of his way to get Democrats to vote for the Sensenbrenner bill, to give them cover for their re-elections, to play this political game by which you say, ultimately, no matter what happens to the bill in the overall, you can run safely, white male Democrat, because you can say you voted for this restrictionist piece of legislation. This is Rahm Emanuel, a Democrat. Let's see, worked for Bill Clinton as top advisor, helped Bill Clinton deport record numbers of people. Worked for Barack Obama as chief of staff, ditto, record numbers of people. Also was in Congress, put immigration reform off the burner, said it was the third rail of American politics, let's not do it. Now he's mayor of Chicago, he's completely remade himself. He wants those of you who don't read newspapers or watch television to believe that he is your amigo, because he is against, he's in favor of sanctuary cities, whatever that means, right? So the only way you don't fall for this crap is by reading, watching TV, listen to the radio, think critically and trust no one. Trust no one, okay? If you voted Democrat for the last 20 years and you're pro-immigrant, you have to leave because those two things are not reconcilable. You did not get to vote for Barack Obama twice and then come back and tell me how you're pro-immigrant. I'm gonna call bullshit on that, okay? That is not a defensible record in any way, shape, or form if you've been paying attention, as I have been. So my sense about knowing your world and knowing yourself is you have to know what's going on. Know yourself in terms of whether you like security or risk. Are you gonna be happy living here or there? Are you gonna be happy spending time with your family or working 60 or 80 hours a week at work? And then know your path, ultimately your talent. There are things you're gonna be good at. You know, God didn't give me artistic ability, athletic ability, musical ability. He gave me the ability to do this. He gave me the ability to communicate. The ability to communicate verbally and in written form, right? And to go up to people who are sometimes are disrespecting my community and to take my fountain pen and stab them in the heart with it. This is what I do. This is what I do, right? Now, as I leave you, since this is Halloween, I have to tell you that one of the people who I've stabbed in the heart before has not died, will not die politically. I feel that to go after him, we're going to need a wooden cross and some garlic. And so it's my misfortune to have to deliver a piece of news to you. You know that you have a governor's race coming up in Colorado. You know, have a number of people who are running for governor. You may know that there are 8 Republicans and 7 Democrats who are running for governor of Colorado. And today, we have the 9th Republican has entered the race. Tom Tancredo is running for governor of Colorado. I told you, a wooden stake with garlic. Yeah. And he, in some respects, he feels like it's not the case that Donald Trump gave birth to Tom Tancredo. It's more the case that Tom Tancredo gave birth to Donald Trump. Tancredo is OG, original gangster. He was there first, right? The most openly nativist member of Congress, period. And he knew a lot about immigration and illegal immigrants because he hired them to build the deck at his house. He was one of the first hypocrites to be called on the mat for criticizing illegal immigration, even as he's putting them to work on his house. And we know that because of the media, and you would know that if you read that story. So, let me just tell you this. This is a great country. It's a beautiful country. We're part of this beautiful country. We are not going to take a backseat to anybody. We're not going to apologize for anything. Because we've never been a drain on this country. We've never been a negative. I constantly have to go fight people in the media, on Fox News or wherever, sometimes on CNN. Some days I'm fighting an ignorant white liberal and sometimes it's an ignorant white conservative. It's just people, right? They're just from their own political bubble, they sort of proceed to tell us about ourselves. They think they know us. They don't really know us. They have all of it backwards. And again, if they think we don't live in this country, if they think we're not patriotic, they really have it backwards. If they think we don't work or value family, they really have it backwards. And so it's our job to constantly do the best we can, to change minds wherever we can, to get people to think, to remind people of our commitments to this country over and over again and our contributions to this country over and over again. I'll end with a story when I was sitting in Israel with Benjamin Netanyahu and 4 other Latino journalists, and he was talking to us about Latinos. His main takeaway was this. He said, look, there's no more important relationship to Israel than the United States of America. And there is no more important community in the United States of America, to my mind, than the Latino community. Okay? And when you think about the fact that a guy who grew up in Sanger, a country mouse nest, in a town of 10,000 people, the grandson of Mexican immigrant, the son of a cop, you know, not the son of a Kennedy or a Rockefeller, but could have the experiences that I've had and done the things that I've done, I mean, that's it. That's a testament, right? As the man said, only in America. Thank you very much. We're doing surprisingly well on time. Okay. So anybody who wants to follow me further, you can follow me on Twitter or, you know, grab one of my business cards or follow me on Facebook and continue the conversation. But now I just quickly want to yield, if possible, to the audience. Can I do that? Okay, great. Just for a few minutes, anybody have a question? Yes. No, I have not been on the Bill Maher show. Well, okay. Yeah. Yeah, well, maybe. Well, maybe. Yeah. I think that people who are progressive Democrats who vote that way are interesting because some of them mean well, and some of them have become so entrenched in what they believe that they feel very comfortable telling me about myself and my community. And I don't know if I'd put Bill in that second category or not, but I do run across that a lot. Elitism, arrogance, Harvard liberals, who mean well, but they don't know their space, okay? And there's a space element. My wife is a dyslexia specialist. She deals with kids who have social learning issues and the like. And a lot of people who are really, really bright and capable don't have social skills. They don't have social skills. They don't know how to deal with their fellow man, right? Their fellow person. And that politically manifests itself when you start to tell somebody about their community. I would never, ever lecture my gay friends about what it means to be gay. I would never think to talk to my African-American friends about what it means to be black. I just wouldn't. That's dumb, right? Doesn't stop white liberals from telling me about myself and about Latinos. Now, you think Latinos only care about immigration. That's not true. They care about all these other issues, too, or the vice versa. It's very interesting. Not sure how we got there. Yes?
Why do you think there's such a lack of Latino journalists?
A lot of us, I think, when we got our education and our graduate school education and the like, we went into business and law. I think we have a lot of lawyers out there. I think that journalism is a very closed off profession for us. I think that journalists are a bunch of, we're a paradox because I spent a lot of my career writing 2,000 columns and 2,000 editorials telling people what to do. I would write an editorial, if I worked for the Denver Post, I'd write an editorial telling the city council, you have to vote this way or that way. So we love telling people what to do. Guess what? Journalists don't like being told what to do. So we're good. You know that old saying about how doctors make the worst patients? Teachers make the worst students? Well, journalists love telling people what to do, but they hate it when you tell them what to do. So when I go to CNN, or I've judged the Pulitzer Prizes 4 times at Columbia, I've been to the show. And when you go to those places and you try to convince them that it's not acceptable that in 45 years of handing out Pulitzers to columnists, only one has ever gone to a Latino in 45 years. They take offense to that. What do you mean by that? Are you implying they were racist? Are you implying they were anti-Latino? But if you make the point about men and women, they somehow can wrap their brain around that very easily. So I think that that's one of the reasons. I have never had much success at NPR, at ABC, at CNN, any of these places convincing people that they don't know what they think they know. And I got an early baptism at this because when I was 18 years old and I went to Harvard, that I encountered that right away. Okay? Yes?
Hi, first of all, thank you so much for everything you said kind of made a lot of sense to me.
Thank you.
One of the most important pieces to me, and that's exactly, you know, where I come from, is I always think about taking care of everybody else first. And that's my nature.
Right.
And so when you talk about, you know, put your mask first and then take
right.
care of your child, that definitely makes sense.
Right.
So in a sense, what is the best advice that you can give us in terms of how can we take ownership of that, taking care of ourselves first, and then pulling the ones behind us, obviously, because that's the nature of not only Latinos, but also women, you know.
That's a very good point. That's a very good point. You know, you probably can't think of one of your tías, comadres, my mom, for sure, who follows what the flight attendant tells her to do. We're not good at that. Latinas are like, what, are you crazy? Are you telling me to put my mask on before I put my kids on? You know, and so we don't listen. We're not obedient that way. It's true. And so you're right. We have a tendency to look out for everybody else first. And I do that too. When I'm cooking breakfast with the kids, I make sure that all the kids ate and my wife ate, right? And then it's they go to school and it's me and the dog. And usually I think, you know what, I didn't eat breakfast. Why didn't I? Because, okay, I get it. But you know, we're trying to be more careful with ourselves. We're trying to take better care of our health, exercise more, walk more. I talked about my knee injury, other things you have. Take care of yourself, you know? You can get it fixed right away, but don't draw it out. And we're careful about what we put in our bodies as consumers of what we eat. We're trying to be more careful about that, but we're not careful about what we put in our mind. So we're good about what we put in our mouth. We're getting there. Organic this, organic that. It's this, it's that. Go to Whole Foods. But we're not careful and critical about what we put in here. And a lot of what goes in here from the media, from my business, from my peeps, is false. It's not true. And it's not just Fox News that's spreading falsehoods. It's CNN, it's MSNBC, it's all of them. They all lie. And I'm not saying they like do it on purpose. They're deep in a bubble where they don't even realize it is a lie. Right? I mean, they state it like a fact. I can't believe I got into an argument on live television last week on Fox News because the people around me were trying to convince me that Mexican immigrants come here to get on welfare, right? Or that we're somehow taking jobs and depressing wages. And they just accept it as a fact. And I push back again and I say, that you are not allowed to call that a fact. Just because everybody in your little tribe believes it and you keep reinforcing it does not mean it's true. And Republicans do that and Democrats do that. You know, Russian collusion, Russian collusion, Russian collusion. Hey, there's Russian collusion. Or maybe it's on the Donald Trump side. You know, they put out this false narrative, these tweets that are lies. He's not telling the truth when he's tweeting. But we got it into our minds somehow. If you repeat a lie over and over and over again, people will buy it. And unfortunately, we're the piñata. We're at the other end of that. So a lot of people are attacking us, not knowing the first thing about us. Yes.
So thanks for your talk. I really appreciate a lot of how you kind of laid out your sort of, you know, what you think we're doing well, but what you think we're doing poorly. I wanted to push back a little bit on the idea of the history being important, especially in the context of kind of what you're mentioning right now. The fact that, you know, on the one hand, if we rely particularly on media in terms of making a better understanding of ourselves in our current moment and, you know, not seeing ourselves as victims, but the media misrepresents us. You know, who's telling our stories when there's five syndicated Latinos nationally?
Right.
So, you know, there's only five people telling our stories, and then there's, you know, you're facing this big monster of a sort of media that's embedded in a sort of, you know, in an economic and social political model of trying to spin a particular narrative about us. I mean, for me, that's why history is important. History is not about staying stuck in the past, but seeing how there's recurring patterns, right?
I hear you.
If we're only paying attention to what's happening now,
and there's
very few of us that are in that position to make what's happening right now, you know, known to a much broader audience.
It's a very good point, and let me respond to that. Yeah. First of all, what you say about media being not pure is completely accurate and true. I agree, but nor is history pure. The reading and writing of history. You're familiar with the phrase "winner's history." You're familiar with the things we learned about in school and the things we didn't learn about in school. Just this morning I was talking on the radio about, we know about Japanese internment, but nobody ever told us about the Italian Americans and German Americans who were interned. There's a lot of things that didn't end up in history books, depending on who wrote them. If you want to listen to the history of the Texas Rangers as told by a white historian in Texas versus Américo Paredes, right? Different. So I yell BS on that, okay, in the sense that what I do is corrupted by nature, but history professors also are dealing with a corrupted text. Having said that, I'm a history major, so I'm in a deficit here. I majored in American history in college. I changed from government to American history, and I'm kind of caught exactly where you are because right now I'm reading, I love biographies and autobiographies, and I'm reading a biography of Robert Kennedy. For me, Bobby Kennedy was the last good one, okay? And I saw that Chris Matthews, who's in this world of media, has a new book out on Bobby Kennedy. We're in love with Bobby Kennedy. and rightfully so, because that's a really wonderful, great history and a great historical figure. But at the end of the day, as much as I love Bobby, and there is in fact a Bobby Kennedy book on my bookshelf or on my nightstand, right? I'm guilty. I don't live there. I can't live there. This is not 1968, and there are no more Bobby Kennedys. So I have to deal with the reality of this. I told somebody once, they said, how did you vote? And I said, I went and I took my kids to vote, and I saw Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. And my kids looked at me, and they said, what are you gonna do? And I looked at the thing, I said, what kind of bullshit is this? I thought we were being punished for what we did to the Indians. This is a plague on America, these two choices, okay? Most of the people who voted for Hillary did so because they didn't like Donald Trump. Most of the people who voted for Trump didn't like Hillary. I didn't like either one, and I refused to vote for either one with a gun to my head. And my kids came away very confused. They're like, well, don't you have to? And I said, mijo, no. I brought you here to vote because it's important to vote. I don't want you to come away with that, but do not let people tell you that you have to vote for one of two very bad choices. And anybody who says these were not bad choices is just lying to themselves. So, you know, I sometimes feel bad because I feel like I'm measuring every politician against Bobby Kennedy. That's an unfair standard. But I'm a history major, I love Bobby. I hear exactly what you're saying. So let's reconcile that out. Yes, thank you. Okay, good.
Thank you, Ruben. Following the program, we're gonna have a dessert reception. And actually, Ruben's gonna be here, so if you wanna ask questions, Ruben will be with us till about 2:30, so you'll be able to go ahead and ask questions. Now, I would like to invite to the stage our morning poet who opened the session for us today, Naomi Ayala. She's gonna also close our session today. So for those of you who were part of us during the morning, I think you all wrote down some information on those index cards that you were given this morning. She has now since then has been working on that to go ahead and create a work, an original work that represents all of us collectively, and is gonna share with you that as part of our closing. Naomi?
Thank you, everyone. Good afternoon. What an honor to work on this piece for us. Thank you for that honor. And thank you for sharing so wholeheartedly, all of you. I did my best to include at least a portion of each of the cards. I am going to read an excerpt of our collective poem. The entire piece is going to be available on the Foundation website. Power. To me, personal power is motivating and empowering my students and the warmth I feel watching the sunset in silence. I develop my personal power by praying while walking in the morning and by reading. Personal power is self-actualization. I develop it by being in the moment and living with passion every day. Power can mean taking advantage of others. It can also mean reclaiming it, but I am still exploring this. To me, personal power is working with others and having everyone contribute their perspectives. I develop my personal power by decolonizing my mind. Personal power is living, laughing, loving, learning. Personal power is ser yo misma, es información, aprendiendo día a día y compartiendo lo aprendido con las personas a mi alrededor. To me, personal power is action and impact, voice, connection to family, energy, happiness, authenticity, empowering inspiration, staying true to my values, living them out and living out my strengths. It's safety, freedom, voice, ambition. I develop my personal power by developing myself physically, mentally, and spiritually, by having perseverance and nurturing myself and others, by connecting to community, by thinking of others and how to empower them, by sharing knowledge, by listening to and caring for my beloved friends and family, by having faith. El poder personal para mí es tener una meta, I develop my personal power cuando pongo esa meta en acción. To me, personal power is my roots, enjoying my culture and showing it to others. It's being strong for my family and the community. I develop my personal power by sharing my knowledge and helping others grow. Personal power is speaking my truth. I develop it by writing. Personal power is accepting that my flaws or perceived limitations can be overcome with courage and perseverance. I develop this power by trying something new and scary each day. I embrace my failures and successes equally. My personal power is confidence and love. Personal power is having the resilience to get up and fight injustice and oppression every day. It's inspiring change, transformation, connecting, seeing opportunities, and teamwork. It's about choice, choosing to love and be positive. It's about the capacity to be present, grateful, and feel energized. I develop my personal power by taking care of negative self-talk, taking time to be alone, by creating excellence, by being intentional and being financially independent, by investing in my personal growth, by dipping my hands in the river and burning piñón incense, by taking time to reflect. Power is brownness, spanning across oceans, digging into lands, knowing ancestors carry us through waters, across forests, releasing medicine, grandmother healers and grandfathers, diahui. Power is our ancestors' voices, deep roots, skin, the color of dirt, prayer and medicine, ceremony, listening to our elders, hugging the earth, mama, pacha mama.
Thank you, Naomi. Thank you very much. That was beautiful. And as she said, it will be available on our website. So if you want to go ahead and visit our website in the next day or two, we should have that up on the website. So that concludes our day today. I want to just really thank all of you for being part of our journey, being part of a day that hoped that inspired you, that uplifted you, that made you think differently, that stretched your mind. Because as I said before in the past, our job is to stretch your mind because it's not like a rubber band, it doesn't go back. Once you stretch it and you see different things, it's only a yearning for being able to go ahead and wanting to learn more, wanting to do more, wanting to act. So I hope today that you will leave with something. You'll go back home, you'll share it with your family. You'll share it with your coworkers tomorrow, this afternoon. And hopefully that just sparks something within you that is going to make a change. For you, for your community, for your family. With that said, I invite all of you then to a dessert reception. We have desserts in the back with coffee and so forth. So please still go ahead and network. A lot of you came from far out. Earlier this morning, we had people raise their hand who did not live here in Denver. And just from what I saw, about 60% of you today are not from Denver. And that's beautiful to be able to see how we're coming together, we're building community, and mapping our strengths to power. Also, you're welcome to take the floral arrangements in the center because we don't have to want to take 18 of these things back to the office. So please take them. I hope you've enjoyed your day. And please stay around and enjoy some desserts and continue the networking. Thank you very much for being with us today.